Okay. Good evening and welcome to the May 12th, 2016 meeting of the Newmarket Conservation Commission. I'd like to call the meeting to order at 10 minutes after 7 p.m. and begin with the Pledge of Allegiance. Great.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Let's do the roll call soon.
Certainly. Jeff Bonnell.
Present.
Present.
Andrea Sellers.
Present.
Bob Gazda.
Present.
Present.
Thank you, Sue. Ezra Temko, Julia St. Clair, and Marianne Hannigan have all given notice that they will not be able to attend this evening. We also have Ellen Snyder, who's been working on our management plan at Wigan Farm for us as a visitor tonight to kind of present her the plan, the draft amendment to the management plan. And so if no one objects, I'd like to move that to the beginning of the meeting.
Fine.
Actually, and before I do that, I might as well just appoint Patrick and Bob as voting members tonight. Excellent. Thank you. Welcome, Ellen.
Okay. Thank you. I'm Ellen Snyder, IBIS Wildlife Consulting. Live in Newmarket. Nice to be here. So just to recap, you have a management plan for the Wigan Farm that was done in 2005. And it's always a good idea to update those every 10 years, but specifically the state of New Hampshire, which holds an easement on the property, requires essentially that you do an update to the plan every 10 years if you're going to do any new, potentially new management or new activity. So it seems like a good idea. Appreciate your willingness to go forward. So what I'm basically doing is an addendum or amendment. So I'm not rewriting the whole plan. I'm just going to, I'm going to make some new maps. The maps that were in here are great, but these are going to be GIS maps, so you'll be able to update them and use them, I think, more quickly and easily if you want to make some trail maps or use them in some other way. So I have just one map. Unfortunately, it's from behind you, so I am going to be referring to that map, and I wanted to just chat about some of the things I've been thinking about in terms of what you might do, say, in the next 10 years with the property, and if there's a few issues that may be happening out there, and then some things related to the boundary. And I think I'll save the boundary for the end, because that's a little bit more complicated than perhaps some of the other stuff I hope that we're going to chat about. So let me just get you oriented. So here's the parking area. This is Grant Road and Doe Farm Road. The orange is the boundary, which we'll get back to. So the parking lot, there's a kiosk. There is a little trail that I think people have made, which is essentially, I think people who live on Doe Farm, instead of coming all the way down here and going in, which is a little bit tricky there on the road, they just cut through the stone wall and that was kind of there before. So seems somewhat innocuous. The trail comes across, there's a bridge here, and the trail system that goes through the field, goes down to the wetland, kind of goes out here. It's a little bit of a triangle there. And then there's this little spur, and then it goes through the field and back up here, back down. I'm always amazed when I'm out there how many people, I see using the property. Seems like a lot of people with dogs, a lot of hunters in the fall, other people just walking, sledding when there's snow. And then there's this snowmobile trail, which sort of keeps going this way. I didn't extend it all the way. And I didn't put it here because it kind of depends on the weather every year, whether it's the pond is frozen enough. This has become quite flooded. The beavers are pretty active, and so even this side is pretty flooded. So it seems to me it depends on what the weather is and whether there's enough snow for snowmobiling, which is something I'll probably talk about in the update to the plan. I don't really have any recommendations for changing the trail system, except you might think about whether the trail should be mowed regularly during the growing season, because right now it's really just the people walking on it, and it keeps it to a pretty narrow path, which is maybe okay, but with this, lots of ticks now, and if you really want it to be a public place and you want people and families to go with kids, I think they might be reluctant if it's not like at least sort of a traditional, whether it's 4-foot or the 8-foot mower. you know, making a mowed path where you're not going to get ticks.
I know last year specifically, more than other years, it wasn't mowed, but I was assured that this year that upon our request, it will be mowed each time.
Yeah, so,
because we didn't make that many requests last year, because Wynn Hilton was volunteering.
Yeah, so whether you get volunteers or whether you have somebody mow it.
I think the town said that they would.
So let me just stay with recreation or sort of public use for now. So the kiosk, I think, is good. I think it would be nice to mow around the kiosk, because what happens is, I know when we put this all in back when, that was a discussion of where the kiosk should go. You don't want to block the view. And so it was put sort of, in some ways, on the other side of the parking area. But then people sort of go right out toward the bridge. And so people don't necessarily go over to the kiosk or walk around it. And there is some information on the back. It's a pretty big kiosk, so moving it seems a bit daunting, and it's nice and it's solid, and it might just be if you were going to mow the trail regularly, just to mow around the kiosk, and I think that would encourage people to go over there. Mm-hmm. The bridge, I think every year it needs to be inspected and tuned up a little bit. It sometimes gets a little rickety on certain places. The other thing I might recommend, it is a little bit steep on the approach and the other side, and I know there's some trails that I've been on in the area where you put metal, like a netting, or whether it's metal or I don't know what it's made of, but on those approaches, so it's not as slippery. Because if it's frosty in the morning, that's a pretty slippery bridge, and you might, you know, people might have some problems with that. Yeah, I think I noticed that everybody seems to stay on the trail. It is a little down in here by the wetland. There's sort of used to be a triangle that was mowed, and then it kind of gets mowed out here. I'm going to make a little bit of a recommendation to not have that triangle, but maybe just to get that, or like if you are going to mow, like you'd probably want to come down here and mow down here too. And I think we should think about whether there should be that triangle or how much of this you want to keep open as a trail. I will talk about some habitat management, and that might dictate what you want to do for a trail, but I don't know, it just seems always a little overgrown down there, and then people don't really know where to go. And so I think I would just like, okay, just have a trail down to the pond, and then maybe have it go out here, but don't make a triangle or something out of it down there.
Is there anything in the previous plan about maybe like that's a fishing spot, and then further, like why they did that way?
No, I think there always was, you know, probably people used to walk down there and fish and hunt and stuff, and I think it's just
Was it for turning the mower around, maybe?
Maybe. It's getting pretty overgrown down there, so it's hard to know. And there was a monitoring well put in, so there was stuff that was done before the town acquired the property. But it must be good to think about like how to do it there. And I'll talk a little bit about the interpretive signs, and that may also dictate what to do here. This just kind of ends, basically ends at the wetland. And you can go out there in the wintertime or if you've got high boots, but which is fine. People can then bushwhack through the rest of the property. I think that's totally fine. Of course, the gate up here, and I'll put the showing the sort of management access path into here. I'm trying to think of other recreational things.
Why is that right around the bridge in that area a different color than the rest of this?
Right, okay, so I can talk to you about what those, and then I'll come back to that. So this purple is the prime wetlands that Newmarket designated a number of years ago.
Is so those were outline of it, yeah. Or is that a brook?
This is a stream.
Outline?
And then a large wetlands, but this line is actually the edge of the wetland.
Okay.
So these are official maps that Newmarket has, and so when somebody comes in to do some sort of development, not here obviously because this is conserved land, but you have to look at these maps and make sure your setback, whatever the setbacks are from these prime wetlands. So that's prime wetland, and this little kind of bluish aqua line, when the previous owner, Mr. Falzone, owned it, he hired a wetland scientist to map the wetlands. So prime wetlands are different than all, a prime wetland is really the highest quality wetland. So there are other wetlands that extend farther back, and he had these wetlands mapped. So everything in here, well, actually, this is a little weird, but this is wetland in here. There should be a line there, and there's wetland here. So this is sort of what they did is they weren't worried. Falzone was never going to develop any of this out here. So he didn't care about mapping the wetland out here. What he was trying to map was what is the edge of the wetland and the upland where he could develop. So this is the edge of the wetland here, and this is the edge of the wetland on this side. Okay, so all this is the edge of the wetland. So all of this is wetland.
Everything inside of the dark blue is wetlands. Is that what you're saying?
All of this is wetland, but so is all of this, because this is actually a finer scale. Think of it as a finer scale mapping of the wetland. So all of this is wetland.
Okay.
Basically, all of this is wetland.
We just categorized differently.
Yeah.
And have different levels of protection on them.
Yeah.
So that's all that.
Oh, I see.
So
it all
this is kind of delineating the edge of a different level of protection and a different quality wetland in general. But they are.
Yeah.
It's all wetland. It's just. Mm-hmm.
But there's an uphill, isn't there? That's upgrade right there to the right of that blue
this
line.
This is all wetland. It's all
there,
low.
Isn't there a hill there?
The hill is right here. So think. Look. Take a look at this dotted blue line. This little line here.
Oh.
So this line. This is the upland you have on the property. So this is field.
Okay.
And this is woods, and this is woods.
Okay.
And here's the hill where people sled.
Oh, okay, that's
here's
it.
The top of the hill.
Okay.
There's a bench.
Right.
Yeah, our developed portion is very small compared to the overall.
Oh, yeah.
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 This is upland here, too.
Oh, okay.
So you have very little upland on this property, and I'll have all the numbers. But
so it's pretty much the scale, this map.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So this is the field, the mowed field. This is the alder swale associated with the wetland that we've been trying to increase over time, so it's a little bit wider. Because when Falzone had it, he mowed it pretty far back, because again, he was trying to maximize and take a look at how many houses can I get in here. So he kind of mowed it back. So we're trying to get a little more of that alder back. And I have some suggestions of it. There's a couple places where the town is mowing a little, what I think is a little close to the wetland and could get a little bit more of the alder to come back, but it's a pretty minor area. It's like a little bit in here, a little bit in here. This is looking great. This is looking good, and this looks great over here too. So you've got the meadow, you've got the alder swale, you've got all the huge wetland system. You've got over here, there's essentially a plantation of red pine and some other softwoods in here. It's not really a native natural habitat, but if you wanted to change that, you'd have to clear cut this, and then you'd be clear cutting right behind everybody's house right there, and I'm not sure that's desirable from many perspectives. Maybe down the road, but I'm going to come back to the habitat stuff. Let me finish with the recreation. So we've got the kiosk, we've got the bridge, we've got the bench here, and there's a bench here, which I think both are really nice and very nice spots. These red dots are the interpretive signs that an Eagle Scout did a number of years ago. And my suggestion for those is that it's been a number of years since those were put in. They're kind of out of date. Some of them are not really relevant, just because in 10 years things change, and what you want to speak to and what you want to talk about has changed. And I think they could be more they're kind of the information on them is sort of broad, very broad, in such that it's not that specific to Wigan Farm, and I think you could tailor those to be really nice interpretive signs specifically for Wigan Farm. And what I was going to do, if you think it would be helpful, is there's not a lot of words that need to go on those. It's like 100 words or less. And I have some ideas about topics for each of those. I think some could come out. I think there's too many, particularly over here, over in the north side.
Mm-hmm.
There's actually three there, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And there's sort of an overabundance over here. But what I was going to do is actually write little blurbs and include it in the addendum to say, here's some ideas for interpretive signs.
One thing I was wondering about, Alan, is one of our missions is to help support kids going on field trips, and specifically with an environmental bent.
Mm-hmm.
Could in some way make it so that if a group from the school came out here, there might be an activity that they could do at those stations. So whether it was certain things, and that way I think if we can not only sponsor a trip to the Wigan Farm, but then we could have it sort of tailor made for a teacher, or if we could get a naturalist to go out there, we'd sort of have something
some ready-made
to,
things.
Yeah,
yeah.
Ready-made.
It's a good idea.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. And I think what I was thinking too, sort of like I like that idea that there's a lot of them over here on that. Again, on that there's too many over there. There's just not that much to interpret. I mean, there's stuff to interpret there, but and so I think you could take a couple of those and put them closer to here, the entrance. So when you enter, there'd probably be one. You go across the bridge. It could be one about something. So there'd be they'd be a little more sprinkled around and in places where it made sense to interpret something. They're nice posts. They actually have this incredible plexi, whatever they used, because if you look at them, they're really still in really good condition in terms of what's underneath them. But and they're very easy to unscrew and put a new piece of information or picture, whatever you want to do there. So so I was going to put some ideas in there. And right, so that's interpretive signs, the trails. I think, you know, it might be good to revisit with the snowmobile club this whole area in terms of getting across the pond. And I'm right here. I think they used to go across there, and then they go across here, and there's like an old bridge lying in the wetland here, and it's just really wet over here. So it's got to be hard to get across there when, in most winters, especially like this winter. I don't even know if they went out there. Over here, it's great. It's just nice woods back in here. But once you get in here, it's really difficult.
So that section that you were just on, well, actually below that, that land in there has no trails. So it's sort of bordered by the orange line.
This one here?
Yeah, that's a bit of upland right there.
Yeah, it's actually, it's okay upland. The problem is getting to it. There's really no access because it's really hard to get across this wetland. It's hard to get across this wetland. It's kind of landlocked because there's private property all along here. So unless you made a bridge, a footbridge to get over here, and it's really not that big of enough a piece to really warrant, like, I don't know, getting people over into that forest. It's
pretty big prime wetland to get across, too.
It's a big prime wetland to get across. It's kind of nice. I walked this whole line, and it's in some ways it's kind of nice because these the property owners on that side, it's nice. Like, you don't see any issues. Like, you know, there's no trash. There's not even trails that people have made. So it's kind of, in some ways, let's, you know, leave that for wildlife or whatever. And maybe, you know, keep focus here. You know, maybe down the road at some point you'd want to think about, like, a boardwalk. You know, you could do some stuff in here. It's not great. You'd have to do it, like, in winter, frozen ground, but you can easily walk through this out here. It's pretty open in the wintertime.
Would it be worthwhile to get over to that other sort of most right area? I mean, I know that's wetland, but...
Over here?
Like, way up.
Yeah.
Next to that sand lot, almost.
Up here?
All the way to the right.
Yes. Oh, over there.
Yeah, like that area.
So if you see this line right here, I mean,
that's the forest.
Well, you see the change. There's a little bit, this looks darker than this.
Yeah. Okay.
This is a really,
wet.
It's really wet. It's really wet, very unique.
Oh, okay.
It's a little bit more unique. This is still pretty wet. This actually is also a wetland, as you can see where that line is, but it's really easy to walk through this. Even like now, you might need rubber boots, but it's pretty open and it's kind of neat. Whether you'd want to have another footpath that went off into there, I think that's something that could be explored.
Is that trees or is that just scrub? Or
it's trees.
Bushes?
It's trees. It's white pine, hemlock, red oak,
okay.
Red maple. Kind of the trees
wet.
You'd expect.
And it's even wet?
It's like, you know, picture the woods that you walk out that's sort of a little bit hummocky. It doesn't look like wetland, but it's wet. It is wet. It's mapped as wet. It's like a flood. It's like a. It's called a forested wetland.
Okay.
And so there's like small depressions. So when it rains heavy, or if there's a lot of snow melt,
You're
gonna see standing water in those really low little.
Yeah, but trees will still sustain.
Yeah, it's very wooded. It's completely wooded.
Okay.
So I wouldn't, and you don't need to manage it in terms of the forest, but if you wanted to have some sort of boardwalk trail or trail out there, it's a possibility.
Do you have any concern about where the snowmobile comes over that sort of edge getting degraded by them?
I don't know if
multiple?
I'm concerned about it being degraded. I just think it's so wet. I don't know how they ever will be able to travel through there unless they decide to come, unless they want to come more inland. and then cross.
They go like straight across the pond, usually, don't they?
They don't.
Yeah, when it's frozen, and they, I don't think they go.
They don't. They basically don't use it until the pond is completely
frozen.
No, I
know. I'm saying though, even when you go across. When you go straight across, you still have to. They go this way.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And that's very wet right there. You see that?
Yeah.
It's like a beaver ditch.
There's basically a ridge of dry land, and that's what they go on.
It's pretty wet though, and it's scrubby, so if they're going on the ridge, they're running over. I mean, that's why I think it would be worth periodically revisiting that whole, where are they going? And you know, with land trusts, every year they want to, you know, they revisit with the snowmobile club. Let's go mm-hmm. take a look at the, you know, if there's a sensitive area, you know, what's the plan? Like, what do you think you're going to do? So it might be good to meet with the snowmobile club once
is
a year.
Is that a natural pond or was that created by a farmer?
I don't think we know. It was probably dug to some extent.
It looks so straight. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it was. There's obviously a natural stream here. And so there was probably a wetland. Obviously, this is all natural wetland. So, but it looks like it was somehow enlarged, right? Yeah.
And the streams to the north of there were ditched.
Yeah. Okay, so that's I mean, it's incredibly diverse property. It's incredibly diverse plant-wise, bird-wise, wildlife-wise, turtles. That pond is amazing in terms of migration and nesting. The field has woodcock. It's a really nice property. That's why I think it would be nice to sort of upgrade the interpretive signs. And you were saying is just to really get better interpretation out there about really how unique it is.
And that fed by natural springs? Is that what that water?
Yeah, this is all natural seepage and groundwater, high water table.
High water table, yeah.
Very low, so rainwater stays put.
And then that all drains to Tuttle Swamp, is that?
Yeah, so there's most of this all goes to the Lamprey River, so it flows north. This is all Tuttle Swamp and flows north to Lamprey. So there's a divide here, which I'm not entirely sure where some of this drains to Ash Swamp. That's why it's called Ash Swamp Road, because so some of this drains to the Piscataquis, which then goes to the Lamprey. So it all goes to the Lamprey eventually, but there's some drainage. This is so, when you get these areas where they're so flat, and you just have a little bit of topography change, the water starts going the other way, but it's very subtle in here. That's why it sort of just gets all called Tuttle Swamp, the whole thing. But there is, I guess, apparently an Ash Swamp over here. Between the time that this first management plan was written in 2005, the Nature Conservancy wrote a watershed plan for the whole Tuttle Swamp watershed, and they did a lot of mapping of the natural communities and wrote about, you know, the uniqueness of it and provided some suggestions. So I'm incorporating some of what they found into the addendum. And Fish and Game has done a new wildlife action plan, so I'll incorporate that. And there's been some additional land protection, so in this whole sort of this general area.
When did the Nature Conservancy?
I'm afraid you're going to ask me when that year was. I don't quite remember. I don't have the date off the top of my head.
But it was sometime after 2005.
Yeah, it could have been 2009. Seems to ring a bell. So let's move to the boundary.
Okay.
Yeah.
So just related to habitat.
Yeah.
Are there, do you see any or do you have any recommendations for management related changes that would enhance habitat?
Right. I sort of skipped
compared
over.
Compared to what we're currently
doing.
You know, for example, we leave the field unmowed, mm-hmm. and that's to provide areas for ground nesting birds to nest and also to leave what milkweed grows there so that it can grow so that monarch butterflies have a place to be. And, you know, so are there other things you might recommend?
Thank you. I just was sort of slipped that. So, right. So the field, the mowing in September is great. The little bit later in September seems to be better for monarchs because they're migrating through that last population. So if you can wait until September, late September, that's great. And if the town's willing to keep doing it, that's awesome. The alders, so this, what I would recommend is in August, make sure there's a contact with, you know, Rick Malasky, his crew, and to know, you know, you're not gonna mow in September, that'd be great. But I think you need to stake, and I'd be happy to go out there whenever. I'd like to see it staked a little farther out into the field where it's not going to get mowed, so we get a little bit more alder. There's a couple spots where it's mowed almost to the sort of wet area, and I think it needs a little bit wider band of alder. And the same thing a little bit in here. So that's related to the field and the alder, and otherwise I think that looks great. There are some on this backside over here. The field is not great in terms of, I guess you would say, productivity. There's a lot of thistle coming in, which is kind of an invasive. And so I have to think about what I'd recommend for that, because it doesn't seem like just the mowing is keeping it under, and it seems to be kind of invading over there, and it's thistle is not very nice.
I mean, like a non-native?
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's a non-native type. So I have to go back and look at that now that the growing season has kind of come along a little farther to see what it's like.
I've seen it back there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I want to mention two other things. One is that there are invasive plants. There's, you know, scattered shrubs that are invasive. There's some along here in the alder. And then there's a bunch, I know you've done work with volunteers along the stone wall in particular. So one of the things I was thinking about, so when you walk through the stone wall here, you come in, there's the bench, and you can tell it's kind of an old, what we call an old field. There's eastern red cedar, there's low juniper, there's still some open herbaceous area, and the trees are really small. So there's an area, there are some tall trees back here, but this area, if you look at the wetland line and the stone wall, it's 3 to 4 acres down to the wetland where the alder are actually getting a little bit big. And one of the things that people think about is one is setting back succession. So you create, again, more shrub habitat, grow some more young forest, and maybe regenerate over by the wetlands so the beaver have a continual supply of food, because we like beaver. So one of my suggestions, and there are, the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department has a grant program, and they will pay for clearing this. So what the recommendation would be to actually do a clear cut in here, but leaving some things you want, like the low-growing juniper, you don't want to take that out. If there's a sort of any native shrubs in there, you'd want to leave those, and they work right around it. They can easily go in there. So it would open up that side, and what my hope would be, and it might be a couple grant sources, is that the invasives could be all taken out at the same time. So you basically would open up that stone wall, take out all the invasives in there, and you can do that mechanically if you get the right operator, not with chemicals. And then you would cut back the forest, and so this would open up, and you would allow it to grow back into a shrubby area, and keep the trail through there. So that's something I was going to propose in the plan. So it's in there; don't have to do it, but it'll be in there. And there's some funding sources I think that would fund that. And the one thing I like about it is that it gives you a chance to get rid of those invasives, which are really difficult when they're growing in the stone wall. And then I think I would tie in taking out some of the other invasives. There's some buckthorn here. There's some multiflora rose. You could get that all at the same time, would be my hope.
Is there a way you could do like an appendix that might recommend some current people?
Yeah.
Seek out with help.
Yeah. No, I'll include that. I will
not in the plan itself, in case it doesn't happen for 6 years and the people change. But
I can do that.
If you contractor or something that.
Yeah, I have a couple people I think would be good.
So in that case, would the stone wall then be removed and rebuilt? Or?
No, you wouldn't touch the stone wall. Oh, okay. The operators would have to
get in around it.
Yeah, okay. They'd have to. They could work around it.
Okay.
Yeah.
There'll be some handwork.
There might be
some hand.
Yeah, these guys are all pretty experienced. There's a lot of these guys. I think mostly guys. Pretty experienced at doing habitat work. So they're very careful around stone walls and all that stuff. So they can work around an old apple tree, or if there's something you want to leave. So I think that sort of intrigues me. There's, again, I mentioned over here this pine stand. I think that's problematic because of the number of houses now that are over here, and it would really change the look of that. And it's just not worth, you know.
Do you think that will perpetuate itself, or do you think it will slowly kind of turn back into
native forest? I think
it'll
eventually, they'll fall down. There's a little bit of spread, but it's not like an invasive where it's just spreading into the room. I don't think so.
If it was going to regenerate eventually into kind of the surrounding forest.
It's completely denuded under there because there's no regeneration under it. So I think
as they die off, do you think it'll come back as the same, or like oak and white pine? And Or do you think it'll just stay red pine?
I mean, I don't know. I think it'll be a long time, but I think it'll change. I think it'll change over time.
It's red or scotch? It's red.
There's red and scotch in there, scotch too. In there, yeah, too. I think there's different things in there.
So, I mean, we could potentially have someone go in and take the red pine out. Yeah. Not the red, I mean the scotch pine out. Yeah. Leave the red pine as being kind of native.
Yeah, it'd have to be handwork, though, I think. Yeah. And I'm not sure it's worth it.
Yeah,
Okay, thanks, Drew, for that question, because I was
sure.
The habitat work, yeah. Yeah, so I think that's the habitat work. So let's visit the boundary for a second. So you do, because the state holds an easement, they monitor the property every year, and you, I think, in most cases, try to go with them. So there's one monitoring report that you have and that goes to the state. Drinking water people get the same copy. Everybody gets this copy of the monitoring report once a year. And I think that's important to just do one visit and one report. So let me back up on the boundary for a second. So when the town acquired this property in 2003, it was from Mr. Falzone, a developer, and there were three lots. So the main lot here, and then there was one over here, and then there was this one. And Mr. Falzone had a deed and conveyed those three lots to the town of Newmarket, 160 acres, for a nice sum. And that's what we thought. The town got this property. The town hired Doucette Survey to do the boundary survey, and it could not be completed before the closing because this is so wet, and it was in the summertime or fall. They wanted to go out in the wintertime to really be able to do the final survey and do it right, and then they had some title work to do. So when they went out there in the field and looked at all the evidence, and they looked at did the title research and looked at all the deeds, this lot, which is 15 acres, was somewhat in question. Before Mr. Falzone bought it from Carlton Fisk, and Carlton Fisk bought it from a Mr. Fox. And Mr. Fox had a deed that said, yeah, these three properties are mine, and I'm selling them to Carlton Fisk, and Carlton Fisk then sells them to Falzone, and Falzone then sells them to the town. Well, when Doucette did the title research, they couldn't find anything going to Mr. Fox for this particular lot here, this 15 acres. It goes back, and then there's a Norton that owns it. But there's a period of time, and I don't remember what the period of time is, between this Norton and the Fox. And so, as Jeff would say, you know, the surveyors can't just say, oh, well, Fox is fine, and we'll move on. So we found this out, and at the time, we met with the town attorney, Mr. Peter Laughlin, and he said, well, you could do a quiet title, which apparently has an expense, and the town decided not to do that. And he said, well, there's this 30-year clause. If you wait 30 years, nobody comes forward, it becomes the town owns it. So that's what I thought, and I thought we're at 30 years. This is 2016 and 2003. Do I have my math right? Something, yeah. I think we're, no, sorry.
Not 30
so,
years.
No, we're not in the acquisition. The deed from Fox is in 1983.
Oh.
So if you go from the Fox deed of 1983, 30 years, and after 30 years of town, according to the attorney, owns it. Well, I brought this up with Jeff, the surveyor, and I also had a friend of mine who's a title researcher, and she said, well, it's not 30 years, it's 35 years. And she wasn't entirely sure if that concept is legitimate. and she said, well, maybe you should check with the title. We have title insurance. You should check with the title insurance, or you should do a quiet title. So now, without that piece, it's 145 acres. So for sure, the town owns 145 acres. And this 15 acres, I think we always thought the town owned it because it was a deed from Fox. But is there a reason to pursue whether the town owns it or not? And the town could do a quiet title, and I don't know what that expense is. Or we could have the current town attorney say, is there really this 35-year deal, and does the town now own it? Now, this is the landfill over here to the east, so the town owns all this. The question is, does it matter? From my perspective, it does, because I don't like the fact that it's so, you know, the town has sort of not really been stewarding it, but somebody should. And the thought was that this was originally part of the acquisition back in 2003. So from my own satisfaction, it would be nice, in my opinion, if the town sorted this out, but it probably doesn't really matter in the long run, but it matters to me, but may not matter to anybody else.
Should matter to the Snowmobile Club.
Yeah, so they, well, if they can't find the owner, they can go through there, apparently.
It's not posted, so.
Not posted,
right.
So.
They have a trail there.
Right. So that's sort of a dilemma with that. I think in terms of the annual monitoring by the state, I think Steve Walker, the fellow from the state, comes in at the end of this Fox Circle and just comes in here and doesn't really go out here. I walked a lot of this. It's again, it's pretty clear. It looks great out there. So nothing's going on of any nefarious sort out there. So that's that boundary.
Question. Is that like a little island of trees?
Yeah, so when you're at the pond and you look out, you see this really big stand of white pine. It's on the island. And when New Hampshire Soil Consultants did the 2003 plan for the town, they assumed the town owned this because it's in their maps. And they talk about that island and they talk about this area. So it was in the first plan. So that's why I was like, okay, now what do I do if I'm going to create maps now that don't have...
Is that like brooks growing, the V in there?
Yeah, so this is like cattails and tall shrubs like blueberries and maleberry. So this is open water. You get cattails, some emergent marsh stuff, and there is a flow.
That's a brook?
There's a brook. Okay. There's a brook, water flows this way, and then pretty much this is all like cattails.
Okay.
And shrubs, wetland shrubs.
Yeah.
But this is very visible. You can't. It's hard to get to because it's wet in between. It's a high ground.
I've been out there twice. I got out there in the summer once.
Yeah.
With high boots on, and in the winter I've gotten out there.
Yeah.
It's not easy.
And I wouldn't call it high ground.
Yeah.
It's a little higher than the surrounding ground.
Yeah.
Right.
But it's not. I mean, it's not 20 feet above the wetlands.
Yeah.
No,
it's not like.
It's more like three.
Yeah.
When there's snow, it almost looks flat right
across.
Yeah.
And pine trees growing on.
But the pines are very visible.
It's a nice stand of pine trees.
It's a nice stand of pine.
What is a quiet title?
It's a good, do you know what a quiet title is?
A quiet title would be when title's not clear, and so you would notice anyone, you'd attempt to notice people who might have interest in the land, and then you would notice it publicly in several public places, and then you have to wait a certain period of time. And then you're actually issued a quiet title judgment, which is illegal. A judge actually issues a quiet title judgment, and then it kind of clears any potential future claims to title outside of the person who applied for the quiet title. So I'm not a lawyer, so and it's not exactly probably it, but that's the gist of it, more or less. Yeah.
Yeah, there's some cost to it.
Advertisement costs. And
I mean, again, just sort of the way I put this stuff together. So in here, we talk about the 160-acre Wigan Farm. Well, that includes that 15 acres. So now do I say, well, sorry, now it's 145-acre Wigan Farm. I mean, it's...
I don't think...
You know?
I mean, I don't think doing a quiet title is a bad thing at all.
Right.
In the long run.
So should I say 160 acres, but say there's an issue with the 15 acres?
Do you have to state the acreage?
I mean, it's everything I do is dependent on the, you know, acres of wetlands and how much, you know, I describe the property. So these guys described it as the 160 acres with that triangle. What I would say is my suggestion would be to continue that and just say, we're a little uncertain about the ownership there. The assumption was
if you continue to use the 160 acres, it'll continue to show that we think we own it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Which helps in a quiet title.
Which is what we want, right?
That's right. What we. I mean, I think we've always thought that.
I agree. I think that makes more sense to just continue to refer to it as it's been referred to before, because we don't have anything directly telling us it's not ours.
That's true. Exactly.
You have an opinion. Yeah. Well. I will say that there is an opinion of a professional land surveyor on record at the Registry of Deeds that is contrary, but different surveyors have different opinions, okay. And it could be valid that someone else does a survey that disagrees and the other surveyor is correct. Mm-hmm. It happens.
there is an opinion out there, but like you said, when the town purchased the land, the town thought they owned it. Mr. Fox, I guess, or the Foxes thought, the Fox family thought they owned it.
Right. And as you said, nobody has said you don't. The town doesn't. I mean, nobody has said, no, you don't. That's ours. So if they come and say, like, oh, sorry, we thought it was ours and we weren't sure, but happy to talk to you.
Do you know who the abutters are on that portion?
Part of this is
the abutters don't have any claim to it.
No, they have no claim to it. This is Fox Circle and then the Nostrum Farm, and their deeds...
Their deeds pretty much
stop at that. I mean, that's the line.
Yeah.
So, yeah, they have no... It's not like, does somebody over here own it? It's just who... Yeah. Somebody along the way just didn't transfer the property.
The person that owns the house in the subdivision wouldn't have a claim to it, most likely, but it might be someone... The person who did the subdivision way back when, their heirs may have claim to it. If they, for some reason, thought that, oh, that back piece was ours, and we have a deed that says it might be ours, and... Our deed is vague too, or something like that, and that you could have. It wouldn't be the people in the subdivision because they bought a very specific piece of land. Mm-hmm. It might be the people previous to that, or somebody's heir from way back when, and that's kind of the. Mm-hmm. But if it was someone that owned, you know, the landfill property, actually owned it, and they sold everything they owned in Newmarket, then perhaps that's how it was, and it wasn't through this. I mean, it can be quite complicated. So.
Hmm.
People in the subdivision probably don't.
Yeah. All right. Well, I think I have guidance. I will write accordingly. So again, sort of back to, we're talking about sort of the monitoring and you walk the boundaries and just sort of check generally. So, I mean, this is all wetland back here, so nothing's going on. It's beautiful. I walked a lot of this. I didn't get in here because it's so wet, but it's pretty impenetrable and it's pretty cool back there, wandering around in there. Let's go along here. All fine. We have the gate. And for better or worse, when this lot was created, it was created really close to the boundary of this property. So you know the owner here and the driveway and the issues there. It'd be good if I knew sort of what your resolution was there so I can put that in the plan. I don't think you've completely resolved it yet, but if you do before I finish the addendum, I can put something in there.
It's in process, so hopefully that'll happen.
Yeah, it's a long issue, so a long-standing issue, so I understand that. And then there's a stone wall along the back and here, and there's a stone wall along here for a little ways. I will recommend that you go out and sign this line. It's pretty clear for a while because it's a stone wall, and I think if you use the map and compass, and the survey here is very clear, the boundary survey. There's a little bit of an issue with some crossover here. Some abutter has got some trail that they've cleared. And I don't know that, it seems pretty clear that the stone wall is the boundary, but I'm going to suggest that you revisit that line and maybe even meet with the neighbors and just revisit together that line and talk about what they're doing and, you know, what you're supposed to do and not to do on the property.
Were there any stakes put in the ground or markers at the boundary?
If you look at the survey, there'll be...
something driven into the ground, rods?
Well, there's a stone wall for a while, and then there's some... there's trees with barbed wire.
And so we go around the back of that to the wall, along the wall, but then the wall ends.
So the stone wall ends. Compromised in places?
The wall ends, and there's a drill hole in the rock at the end of the wall.
No, I don't think so.
And then...
There's a gap in the stone wall.
We could trace it out. We could walk it and find it.
And then there's no stone wall for a while.
Then there's about 86 feet, it looks like, from the end of the wall to the first big tree with barbed wire and a blaze. So there's a gap with potentially nothing there.
No, I don't know that he walked down here. He walks this around here because that's been a long-standing issue, but I don't know that he walked further down this line.
Because after this it gets quite wet.
He kind of goes into the wetland and he probably thought, oh, well, that's probably fine. But I will let him know that when he coordinates with you guys on the next time, he should walk that line. Take a look.
Yeah, that's at the back of the Dearborn thing, yeah. Because Steve took a picture, I believe, of that when he monitored the Dearborn property. I think he walked back in there.
Where, over here?
Yeah. Do you think he did? Maybe not. Maybe it's kind of wet out
there. It's not that. The issue is back in here.
No, I know. Drew is looking at something.
Yeah, okay. But I wandered around out here, and it looked beautiful. no issues. There's one little tiny fire pit out here somewhere that obviously some people had a little fire.
Is that trail that you were just talking about, is that something that could be, I don't know, useful to connect to our loop trail?
Would
that have any benefit
no.
in any way?
No, the problem is it would bring them everybody really close to their backyards. I don't think I'd put a trail there. If I was going to do another trail, I would go out in here.
Yeah, it almost looks like where you just were, there's sort of a something.
I mean, you could almost, you'd have to do boardwalks and stuff. You could come out here and hook up to this with a boardwalk, make another bigger loop through the woods.
Okay.
You know, there is no other, it's a pretty small trail system right as it is
right.
through the field. It's very nice. But it might be fun to add another loop out there. And I could sketch in something.
It almost looks like that line you traced with my eye of faith, I can see.
Yeah.
Know, it almost looks like there's something there.
Yeah. I mean, it is wet in there, so it's kind of tricky, but.
I haven't been out there in a while, but last time, like, not even knee-high rubber boots were okay in the summer, and it was
quite
nice.
Yeah, I mean,
nice
the thing is,
there.
it's 160 acres. Mm-hmm. It's pretty cool, and I don't think, as long as, you know, people aren't, you know, there is no mountain biking on the property, so it's the trails are I think are well maintained by people. They're not abused, and you know, to get out in here would be pretty cool. It's nice out there. Mm-hmm. So I'll take a look at that, and you know, maybe even getting, I don't know, you really can't get out to this wetland system. That gets pretty wet, although it's also very dry out here, so you could. I'll see. Is that of interest? Do you want me to think about a potential trail out here, or leave it the way it is, or just have it in the field? It's one of those things where you could go either way.
I know. I think
like
it's interesting.
Trail.
But
I mean, another trail would be nice.
Yeah.
That would be something we'd have to maintain and clear.
Mm-hmm.
It would have to be boardwalk.
Putting it in well, like,
it'd be a huge project.
You might want like Appalachian Mountain Club to come and help think about how it should get put in, you know, because it's a sensitive area.
Mm.
Sensitive, I mean, it's wet. It's a little wet, so if you do it wrong, you're going to be constantly wet. But, I don't know.
So, yeah, timber walkways and stuff like that.
Yeah. But, or you could.
I mean, that's a large undertaking. I like having some trailless forest for people to explore as well.
Yeah,
and hunters,
I mean,
to have space
people
in.
People can wander out there. I mean, I think just, yeah. Take kids out there and wander around out there. The monitoring wells.
I'm not opposed to it, but I also like to have those spaces as well.
That's probably good. I mean, I think, I agree. I think trails, it's hard to maintain trails.
How was the ticks out there when you were?
When I went out there, they weren't bad, but it's been a little while since I've been out there.
But in wet areas, the ticks more?
Oh, they're not bad in there. No, ticks like, ticks are the worst in dry, grass, scrubby areas.
It's worse in dry instead of wet.
You're
okay.
In like an oak, regenerating oak, blueberry, low bush blueberry, sweet fern, thick area like that, that's where the ticks are.
Okay.
This is very open. There's not many ticks in here.
Yeah, they're bad. They're usually bad in the meadowy areas adjacent to wetlands, where they've got the waist-high shrubs. And
Yeah.
But not, not open forest.
Okay, so let's recap. I know you got a lot to do. So recap, I will recommend something about the interpretive signs. I'm going to recommend that you take a look at your bridge and do a couple things to that, make sure it's safe. Parking lot seems fine. It looks like it needs a little bit of grading, but and we'll talk about the mowing. So mowing the trail and mowing the field, leaving a little bit more of the alder area. I'll include something about this 3 to 4 acre if you decide you want to go ahead and do some early successional work there, which is called early successional work, and the boundary issues.
Can I suggest, I ask one if one thing would be appropriate? If what do you think we should put for stakes at the limits? Do you think wooden stakes are fine for now, or do you think we should do something that's more lasting?
No, I think wooden stakes are fine. There are some that are still out there.
Do you think...
I'd put pink flagging at the top. Like, if you can get the taller ones, they're a little more expensive, but like the 6 foot ones.
6 foot ones.
Because if they use the 4 foot ones, the mower, I think, can't see them very well.
I guess, do you think that if B
before you make any final maps, perhaps we could go put some stakes and maybe locate them so that when you make the maps, we can show the new proposed limits of mowing on there.
Yeah, it's not a lot. It's
and then you'd have a GIS location.
Yeah.
We could go restake if someone was ever, where was that stake? We could actually go replace
it's
it.
It's not a major change. It's just a little bit, it's particularly in here. And the really cool thing was, I thought was cool, is that, you know, this was all cleared by Falzone, essentially. And even this, there was just a narrow, if you remember, there was a narrow strip of alder, and this was had been mowed down. So a really nice area has been left unmowed here, and it's really coming up in alder, and it's neat. So you cross the bridge, and so I went out there in April, sometime in April, for woodcock, because woodcock are migrating through at that time, and they do that painting. So you can go out before dawn or after dusk, and you hear them. I think I was out there in the morning one time, and there was a woodcock in this area. Well, you know, they go out in the field and they paint, they do their little dance here, but I'm sure they were using this alder during the day. And I thought it was pretty cool, because that means it worked. That means leaving a wider swath of alder there was beneficial to the woodcock, because there was one hanging out right here. And the really funny thing was, some of these people get up early. So their lights come out, and I'm sure they were like shining right on the woodcock, because it was right there. Hmm. So obviously they don't mind. I mean, that wasn't disturbing the woodcock, but having that alder was beneficial. So I thought that was kind of neat. And then I heard there was one over here, and there could have been more back here, but I was only in this area.
They seem to be pretty hard to disturb. I have one that nests in my yard every year,
nice.
And within about 250 feet of my house every year it nests, and it flies. I hear it. You know, obviously, all the time. Sometimes in the middle of the night, you hear it. Like, flies like right across the front of my house. Around my yard. So. Huh. And they are certainly seem hard to scare off.
Do we have birdhouses up over there?
No, we don't tend to recommend birdhouses. I mean, as a biologist, we don't necessarily, unless it's really needed. Because the reason birdhouses were so popular at a time was that. One, the birds had been hit pretty hard with DDT and all that kind of stuff, and so their populations declined. And then there had been all that forest clearing, so the forest hadn't matured back, and so there weren't a lot of cavity trees.
Oh, okay.
Which is where the tree swallows and bluebirds and other ducks, wood ducks. And so there was a period of time where building wood ducks and putting them out and putting bluebird boxes out was really helpful to those bird populations. But they've kind of recovered in pretty nice, like bluebirds are all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing with nest boxes is you have to maintain them,
right.
Like any other infrastructure, and they tend not to get maintained over time. Great energy usually in the beginning and for a few years.
Right.
And it's a nice, I know a lot of people like to do them as projects, but it's really not, from a biological perspective, not recommended anymore.
Because
there's a lot of natural cavities.
There were some down by the pond.
Yeah, and they're pretty well deteriorated. I found there's one that's lying on the ground out there. And the problem with them is they can become sinks for predators and things that are, then it sort of totally defeats the purpose.
Okay.
And it's just one more thing to maintain that just
that's
look for natural cavities.
That's an interesting point for our Piscassic Lizell, where we have birdhouses.
Yeah, I mean, it's not to say that they're like a horrible thing or that
no, but maybe when they deteriorate, they don't need to be replaced.
But again, it's one more thing to maintain. Yeah. And there are bluebirds out there. And there are no bluebird boxes, so they're finding cavities. Yeah.
Excellent.
I think that was everything.
I had a question.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You referred first to setback succession, which is that
early succession.
Early.
It's just succession is how you know the plants grow over time, and early would be we're setting it back, so we want like a meadow, old field, like shrubby habitat.
Excellent.
And as far as I know, does anybody have an update on the water the monitoring wells and the water quality monitoring? Any?
Is
there anything related to this property in relation to the drift of any underground?
We don't get reports that I know of.
Not that I know.
Okay, you don't know of anything. Okay, I just wanted to see if there was anything I should put in about that. I think the monitoring wells are actually right in here.
They might be, yeah.
There's a couple out here. I thought they were on this property, but I mapped them and they ended up over here.
Yeah. Yeah, I know there's some around the other side of the.
It's a long way for those
guys. There's some like pretty far on the other side of the landfill as well.
Yeah.
Like almost out to 152 mm-hmm. in the swamp.
A little
off the road.
Nice property.
So thank you very much, Ellen.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd like to get out there a few more times in May, so I forget if I can get you a draft in June.
That sounds good.
If you guys look at it, and then I can make revisions.
Okay.
Does that sound all right?
That sounds excellent. Great. Yeah. Okay. Or do you want us to schedule you to come back then, or do you just want to kind of send it off to us, and then we can look at it, talk about it at our meeting in June, and then...
Yeah. Yeah, back. Let's do that, just in case. But let's plan on me coming. Let's shoot for June that we talk about the final version. Like, you'll get it before the June meeting.
Okay.
And then we can talk about it at the June meeting, because I'd like to get it done by then, actually.
Okay. I'll email you to see if I can meet you out there or something and put some stakes. I have some stakes in the back of my truck you can take.
Yeah.
It's open.
It's not a big area, and I've got some pink flagging. So we can
There's pink flagging in there, too.
Yeah, sounds
but
good.
You leave. But, so just to help out with the maps before then.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much,
Ellen. Feel free to email if you have something comes up and you have some ideas. Could one of you guys email me about your plan for the boundary around the other? I need to put something in there about that issue, because it's kind of an important one.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah,
I don't know how to turn that off.
That's okay.
Thank you.
Thanks again, Ellen. Good evening. Okay. Next thing is public comments, which we would have offered earlier, but there are no public. Here, there is no public. There are no public. Is no public, whatever. Here to comment. So the next item would be approval of minutes from April 14th, 2016. And Sue sent them around. Drew had a couple of comments. They have been amended very slightly. I don't know if folks want to hear where they were amended or.
No, it was just that I was calling us.
No, I just. Andrea looked like she was curious.
Oh, okay. I'm fine then.
Typos or something?
Yeah, they're typos. They're very
typos. Okay.
Yeah, I don't care.
So I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes as amended.
I'll second that motion.
For discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Is 5-0. Next item would be the treasurer's report.
Okay. I have not too much going on. $1,500 was, I believe, a deduction for what I believe is the fishing derby.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly right. I went in and I took care. I have a check request for you, and they did it. It was simply, they have their own kind of fund within the town system now.
Okay.
So it was a simple transfer. So that's why it showed up so quick, because it wasn't a check that they had to issue. And
okay, I will bring this over. Do I need to bring this over? It was
No. It's all clear. It's done.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
It's a done deal.
Okay.
They are all set, and they are very thankful for the money this year, as usual.
Yeah.
Is this? These are two. These are a couple of current use items that were deposited.
Yeah, I noticed that.
Those are new from April 22nd.
Does that have something to do with the development that's going down there?
I'm guessing on Neil. I don't know. I don't want to. But I know there was a subdivision that was completed on Neil Mill Road, but I didn't know that they actually started to build anything, so I'm not exactly
positive. There's a house down there that has been built.
Is it really?
It's on the MLS. Something.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Is it not, it's not just like a picture of a proposed house?
Possibly. Or it's.
I rode my bike through there the other day, and I didn't. But maybe they did.
Off of Neil Mill, like you could see it from Neil Mill Road, or is it?
The lot's all front on Neil Mill Road, but that doesn't mean we'd be able to see the house.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if there's a shared driveway where Don Tucker's driveway used to be, because he had a long driveway and he couldn't see his house.
Right. No, I can just shoot an email and ask about these things.
Yeah. There's three. There's one on Grant Road, which I can't quite read the end of, so I'm not sure. It's $1,000.
Yeah.
And there's one for $6,250 on Neil Mill.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's one for $250 that says 22 Neil Mill. But like I said, they're cut off a little bit, so I can't really see exactly.
Yeah.
Those?
I'll ask, and then I'll tell you in June.
Sure.
Okay. Thank you, Andrew. The next would be committee and subcommittee reports. Our new town council rep, Phil Nazaro, is not present this evening, so I assume there will be no town council news. And Ezra is not able to make it tonight, but he asked that I kind of give a quick synopsis of some things that went occurred at the planning board meeting the other evening. I made it out there. The one thing that we might have interest in is just Leela Love out on Bay Road had some land that was in a conservation easement already, and it was connected to a house lot where they took down an old house that was out there. It was kind of a rundown old house, and they took the house down, and they successfully, I believe they got through the whole subdivision last on Tuesday night. It's the first meeting, and I think it did pass. They approved, but I was kind of trying to look something else up, and I didn't catch quite. But the gist of it is that they cut the house lot off, and they combined the land with the easement on it with another piece of property that also has an easement on it. So instead of it being a piece of property with half an easement or most an easement and a little exclusion area, that's now a lot with no easement on it and a much bigger lot with easement on it. So it's just basically a reorganization of the underlying ownership of a piece of property so that the underlying ownership is, I think it's more protected, I guess, in some way. So anyway, there was that. And the other thing that I think we'll have interest in down the road is an open space subdivision, which is one of the reasons I went, that's supposed to occur on Dame Road. I don't know if you've been down Dame Road lately. There's a lot of flagging on the right-hand side as you go away from 108. There's a piece of property kind of connects across through. There's two lots out there. I guess they're going to try to do work and kind of connects out to Bay Road, where there's kind of like a little gravel entrance on Bay Road and the wetland you can see out behind it. So it's all kind of together in this subdivision. And they didn't have everything in order, and so they didn't speak about it, and it was continued to the next meeting when they'll really start to get into it. So they didn't really talk about it much, but it is an open space subdivision. The lot has a lot of wetlands on it, a lot of ledge. It's a interesting piece of property, and it'll be interesting to see that process move forward with that parcel. And hopefully we'll hear more about it. And the other interesting thing was they went over kind of their almost final future land use chapter of the town's master plan, where there's this, it was a very interesting plan. They have a lot of good things. If you haven't read it, I suggest people go to the town website and read it. I don't want to talk about it forever, but there is a residential coastal protection district that covers a lot of the land in the New Road area and a lot of the land east of Bay Road, some west of Bay Road. It covers a big chunk of the eastern part of Newmarket around the bay, and it's kind of it looks like an overlay district. So there'll be underlying zones with some additional protections and additional suggestions. And it's not actual zoning yet. It's just kind of a recommendation framework that they can work under in the future. It kind of has to be in the master plan for them to create the zoning. So that's kind of, it was interesting. And then they had also stuff in there to do with kind of climate change, like sea level rise and kind of stormwater management, kind of dealing with those things, or you know, the ability to let the town create rules and ordinances to help deal with that, or zoning changes. So it was a very interesting discussion. And the objections to, there was a family there objecting to quite a bit of it, but it wasn't really, doesn't have to do a lot to do with conservation necessarily, so I'm not going to even get into it. So, but I think it's a very interesting plan. I think they did a good job, and they looked into a lot of really, really good things. And I suggest people read it, check it out.
So. That's online, you said?
Yep. Okay. It's on Google Docs, and there's links to it on the town's website. I know Ezra brought it up a couple of times, said, hey, we're going to be talking about this, and then he had obligations and whatnot, and I think it kind of fell through the cracks on our end.
I'm just kind of curious. When you own property along the bay, do you actually own right up to the water line, or is there like a buffer zone that that belongs to the town or,
I mean, but traditional ownership would be in the state of New Hampshire is to mean high water. What is the traditional boundary between state lands or the public trust lands? It has, the town doesn't have any specific rights necessarily.
Oh, okay.
And
that's something that could change when they consider new flood data, is that what?
Not necessarily, I mean, depends on what you describe as rights, right? Is a wetland setback a right that the town has on your property, as a shoreline protection, but essentially your property has the potential to go to mean high water.
I didn't want to get into the weeds about this because I'll read it on I'll do some research, but I was wondering if that was what the concern about this conserving the land along the bay was about.
Not at all.
The land was actually owned by the state or by the town or and not.
No, it's an what they were talking about is an overlay district, which is similar to like a wetland overlay district that we have for wetland setbacks and whatnot. So, they're not trying to take anything. They're trying to, it gives the town the ability to modify zoning or create zoning that would have the potential to help lessen. Development's impact on the bay.
Right.
And it would encourage open space design, and the contention was that I don't even want to get into it, but it had to do with industrial zoned areas being rezoned.
I'll read about it. Thank you.
I'm not that up on it, and I don't want to misspeak because it was contentious.
Yeah,
but I would look into it. They left. So what they ended up doing is they left that the residential coastal protection district, they left it open until their next meeting for further discussion. The rest of it, they kind of said, the rest of it's set in stone. It is what it is. That's what we're going to recommend. But we'll revisit this at our next meeting because they talked about it for almost 2 hours.
Okay.
Or it was an hour and a half solid. I did speak a little bit, but not on behalf of the commission. I announced before I spoke. Because I said, someone from the commission's here and wants to talk to me. Not here to represent the Conservation Commission in any way, shape, or form. But anyhow, any other subcommittee things? So onto the chairman's report, not much this evening. Just we did get a thank you letter and donation from Loco Sports for the use of Shanda Park for the Great Bay Half Marathon. And I'll pass the check along to Andrea. It is a check for $250. And I can read this quick. It's only three sentences. It says, Loco Sports recently held the Great Bay Half Marathon / Beyond the Rainbow 5K in our beautiful town of Newmarket, New Hampshire. We are happy to make a $250 donation to the Newmarket Conservation Commission. Shanda Park was enjoyed by many of the runners after the race, and we were proud to show off a wonderful spot in our town. Sincerely, Linda St. Laurent, Great Bay Half Marathon 5K Race Director. Mm. So, thank you, Loco Sports. Hopefully put the money to good use. Next item was the Newmarket Fishing Derby we already spoke about. It's not in June, is it?
It's Father's Day, yeah. And just the only thing I would add is that Amanda got the work done on the pond, and it looks good. It's been retrofitted with a new, a valve at the end, sort of where they let the water out, but they can also stop it to create the pond. So they've fixed that, and I'm sure they're excited about that because that will make a better fishing derby for all the kids and. Mm. Dads,
moms.
Do you know?
Moms. They do it on Father's Day. So
right.
They make a big deal about the dads, but there are moms there, yes.
And it is next month on Father's Day. I don't know the date or the time, but I'm sure you could get to it from the town's website.
Whatever Father's Day Saturday, that Saturday is before Father's Day. So I think it might be the 18th of June.
I linked it in the last minutes.
You can either
there was a Shanda Park request from the church too?
18th or 19th.
I think it's the 18th, it's Saturday.
Saturday, yeah.
Saturday, June 18th?
Yep.
Sorry.
Okay.
Please bring it up. Can you bring it up under old business?
Yes.
Or new business, I mean?
Yes.
You can go first in new business. I apologize for that.
Do you remember what I'm talking about?
I sure do, yeah. Should have taken Drew's suggestion a long time ago where the second an email comes in, add it to the agenda.
Easier said than done.
Yeah, it is easier because I have a phone.
I know, well, I looked at it.
I open on my phone and then I get home and then I don't see it as new email. Sorry about that.
No problem.
So the last thing I really have under chairman's report is that once again, the Chris Schottmeyer committee is still moving forward. So things are progressing. And once again, when the time comes appropriate, hopefully we can share more. We got a little bit of mail, but nothing I don't think is very. There is a Rec Connect event Thursday, May 26th. Not positive if we all got invitations to it or not. I tried to ask the question, but I didn't get an answer.
Can I look at it? Yes. See if it rings a bell.
So I don't know if I'll be able to.
I'm
going to
say
it.
I did not get this.
It came in a suspicious blue envelope. So I don't
suspicious.
Know. Suspicious.
Oh,
it was.
See, maybe I don't qualify as this first sentence.
That's why I tried to ask. But it wasn't.
I thought you were talking about like a.
At the planning board committee, it was announced. So I don't know. But
it's on when?
May
26.
Yes.
Oh,
sorry.
It's 6 p.m.
6 p.m.
May 26. Yep.
Downtown Mill Space.
Yeah, there's also something about New Hampshire, the 2016 Lakes Congress at Blue Lakes, Blue Lakes, Blue Mind, Learn, Train, and Network in the New Hampshire Lakes region. I don't know anything about it. I just opened it. Pass around if anyone's interested. We do help fund visiting those sorts of events. That is all I have for the chairman's report this evening. Now, Andrea has some new business that she'd like to bring up that I
the
overlooked.
The community church would like to request the use of Shanda Park for this Saturday, May 14th, from 4 to 7 p.m. for a confirmation class barbecue.
4 to...
4 to what?
4 to what time?
7 p.m.
And you did the request was accompanied by the form, I believe. Right? You sent a PDF, I think.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, to you, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know of any other conflicting use.
Neither do I.
And with that in mind, I would make a motion to have the Conservation Commission agree to permit the community church to use Shanda Park on May 14th from 4 to 7.
Second. Am I allowed to do that?
I'll second
sure.
It if you don't. So,
okay.
Or if you feel you can't. All those in any further discussion, actually? Questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? 5-0. Thank you. And I will I'll print that out tomorrow.
Okay.
Sign it. I don't know if you want to pick it up or if you want me to drop it off at town hall. Or
yeah.
Usually we give one to the police department as well.
Sure. I'll let them know.
Okay. The next item under all the new business is Ellen, and we took care of that. The Newmarket Recreation Department kayak storage at Shanda Park and Piscassic River Landing. I did hear from Amy of the Rec Department that they did get the grant that they were seeking that was directly related to the kayak racks. So they did wait for that. And she also said that she had just gotten word from LRAC that they also approved the kayak race grant. So they've gotten everything that they needed to hopefully keep that process moving forward.
Mm.
So the rest of that's just about the Rec Connect.
Do we have a date on the race yet so that we have that on the calendar for Shenandoah Park? Because I'm assuming they're going to need to reserve that.
See, I did because when she was here last, I said that I would send over the application form, and I did. And she didn't get any back to me,
okay.
Any request forms back.
I know it's in August, so I didn't
yeah,
know if that we typically get a lot of events requests in August, but I'm assuming they're going to need it for
We had hoped that she would supply them for
The kayak event is scheduled for Saturday, August 20th from 11 to 4.
I know she gave us a thing about all the events she was planning on having in Shenandoah Park.
The permits were for the Halloween haunt, the summer concert series, and whatever else.
Yeah.
I forget where we left off.
Well, we said that we would supply her with the application, and we hope that she would fill them out like
right.
everyone else has to. And,
yep.
And I sent them over to her, but she hasn't gotten them back. I'll jog her memory about that.
Sure.
See. We'd most likely give her the ability to do it, but once again, like Bruce stated, there's a reason we do it so that there aren't conflicts.
Right, true.
So okay. it's not to force her to fill out paperwork, because I'm sure she has plenty to do.
Related to that, I did go down and sort of did a wingspan measurement of
mm-hmm.
where the proposed kayak racks would go, and it did seem as though two kayak racks would fit sort of in that area that we had talked about and would not be obtrusive, I think is the way to say it. There's sort of a border of pine trees between the house that's there and where the kayak racks would be. And the home also has a boat in the driveway right now. So there's a visual obstruction of the boat, and then there's a visual obstruction of the trees before the kayak rack. So it's not as if the kayak racks would be this singular thing interrupting their view out towards the water.
Mm-hmm.
And it seemed as though it would fit reasonably within that space without being right on the water passing through that area, the little brook or whatever, and not right on the road on the other side. So it seemed like a reasonable spot for the two racks to be and not be obtrusive.
Can it be put in there like diagonally so it's hidden as much as possible?
I think they have to be perpendicular
to the path. Perpendicular to the path.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay. Oh, really? Why is that?
Easy getting your kayak
it's,
in
yeah,
there.
Just for getting ease.
Oh, okay.
Ease of access.
Okay. Okay.
And it's plenty deep too.
Yeah.
It seemed like it had an extra like maybe 4 feet between where the ends of the kayaks might be and the brick path.
Yeah.
The depth was like 16.
I think it'll see a lot of use.
16 feet deep, I think.
Seems
right
cool.
there.
Mm-hmm.
So, give or take. Sorry, I just have to write a note for a second. That's basically it for that topic that I have. And the next item is the Piscassic Loiselle and Shenandoah Park kiosks. We had a work day Sunday morning, this past Sunday. Drew and Bob and myself worked with Kevin. And we actually, I should take it back another step. They were not... The bases were not in at our last meeting, were they?
I don't think so. No.
Yeah, so since our last meeting, Kevin Martin, the fellow who we contracted with to build the two kiosks, he met out on site with Rick Malasky at the DPW and perhaps another fellow or someone else from DPW, and they installed the frame for the Piscassic Loiselle kiosk. And it looks quite well. They did it on a weekday. And thank you very much to DPW for helping out on that. Much appreciated. And so that went in, and it looks really nice. And then this past Sunday, like I said, Bob and Drew and myself worked with Kevin to kind of install like the framework for that the roof will sit on. And thank you guys for coming
sure.
out. And so So a little more work needs to be done on that to finalize it. We need to put the backer board on and shingle the roof. I think that's going to happen. Actually, that's definitely going to happen this Sunday morning at 9 a.m. if anyone is interested in coming to help. I'll definitely be there, and Kevin will be there. I don't know if I suggested in the email, but I kind of maybe did that. I was hoping that we could just, like, do it.
Finish it off.
Just finish it, because I really think that if we kind of put our minds to it, it won't take more than a couple of hours to put that stuff together.
We should probably make, you know, if we're going to try to finish it, he'd have to bring everything out there, like the shingles and the stuff. So I definitely plan to be there.
Okay, excellent. And, I'll look back through the email and reread it and see if I thought I might have suggested that, but I can't quite remember if I did.
Because last time he just brought what he thought we would accomplish in the 4 hours that we were out there.
Yeah.
But if he knows in advance that we'd like to finish it, he'd bring everything out.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not even... Were we out there for 4 hours? Was it that long? I don't even know. I don't really think
we were out there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, that'll be this Sunday at 9 a.m. And so the next item...
Oh, can I add... I spoke with Dick Lord from LRAC last weekend, and he apparently helped with installing the Shanda Park kiosk and said that he would be willing to work on that project.
Excellent.
As well, if we let him know. So when that starts, he would like to be notified.
Excellent. Yeah, that was the next thing I was going to bring up. No, that's fine.
I thought we were moving on to topics.
How dare
moving
you?
Moving down to the next thing.
No, I was going to just talk about Shanda really quick.
Oh, okay.
So preliminarily looking at it with Kevin, we thought that adjacent to the parking lot, there's a couple of meters, electrical meters, and then there's like a big, I believe it's called a U, a big shrub, evergreen shrub, that's kind of between the brick path and the electrical meters, and on the back side of it would be the creek, and then there's the flat grassy area adjacent to the parking lot. So we're hoping with the direction of DPW, who says they should be able to help install those posts as well in that frame, that we'll be able to just make sure there are no buried electric lines coming out of the meter and feeding the lights that are in the park. So that's kind of like where we thought it should go, kind of perpendicular to the edge of the parking lot, so that if you're in the parking lot looking out at the river, you're not looking at a sign instead of the river. Mm. And then if you get out, it's kind of right there. It's on your way into the park. It's close by. So the backside of it would be up against kind of the U, or the shrub that's there. So that was our thought. If folks are down there and they look and they just send an email if you object to it. Otherwise, we'll assume it's okay. But if you're down there, just take a look.
I don't think it's going to be as easy digging post holes down there as it was out at Loiselle.
I agree. It's probably fill.
Yeah, rocks and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know how.
Hopefully
that's
they have an auger, some kind of mechanical thing.
The town had an auger out there. I didn't ask if it was mechanical. I assume it was mechanical, but there are hand augers, so I don't know.
Kevin told me they dug it with a shovel as much as they could, and then they started filling back in because it's all sand down there. So
yeah. I thought he said they augered it and then it filled in.
Yeah.
And then redug with a shovel.
And then finished it with a shovel as much as they. But it was very fine sand down there. It won't be that way downtown.
No, I don't think so. Yeah, definitely not. It's certainly fill.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
We'll see. DPW will be there, and I'm sure they have. If they need other materials, I'm sure they'll go. They know that they can. If they need a bag of concrete or something, they can buy it, mix it, and bill us for it. So. So that's basically it. Unless anyone has anything to add on those. I know that we just need to get the sign to Kevin so we can make sure he's got his sizing properly. So if anyone, I'm not sure where Kevin's shop is, but...
He gives an address, something in Epping.
Yeah.
At the end of his emails.
If anyone is...
It's in Epping.
Yeah, that's right. And it's on the proposal he gave us. Yeah, and then the signature in his emails. So if anyone thinks about it, or... Yeah, because we should get it to him before... You know what? If anyone can get it tomorrow, does anyone have time tomorrow?
Tomorrow's bad.
was going to say, because then we can hand it off to him on Sunday. When we see him.
What are we looking for?
The sign
the
that was...
The physical sign?
The physical sign that was on the... Yeah. I know it's at DPW. I might be able to go get it tomorrow. Because I'm working in the office. I can try if I have some...
So is anyone out there at DPW that could grab it, or is it something that has to be extracted from the sign? Or what?
I think they took it off the backer and it's just sitting there somewhere. Like they have some turtle signs of ours over there too, and like they have like a sign bin maybe or something.
So it's locked up.
Yeah, the DPW has it somewhere, and I think if I went over there during the day, somebody would be able to get it. But it's just a matter of Kevin not cutting anything. Too
short,
too narrow, or something like that. So I can try to get that tomorrow. So the next item I have on here was our Liberty Mutual Serve with Liberty Volunteer Day. That if Patrick would like to, because he works there and he kind of spearheaded this, if you'd like to talk about
first it. First, I would like to thank Jeff, because it would not have happened without Jeff. And Andrew's husband also was helpful in dropping off the tools that we definitely needed. So thanks to both of you. I think it was a success. I think what was great was we got the three other people that volunteered with me from Liberty were also all from Newmarket, so they got exposed to what we do and you know what's going on. All of them had lived there their whole life and never been to this spot, so that was kind of cool.
Interesting. Yeah.
So, and so they have a network of people and they'll tell them what they did. So that's one of the side benefits. But yeah, I'm hoping now we've got a lot of lead time. It won't be too early before I'll bring this up maybe next fall, and what I'd like to do is say, go to Rick, maybe Mulaski or Steve in town government and say, we should create a list of things and submit them as one big project, and we could get, you know, a lot more people signed up. I think if we had more things going on, we could come up with one for the Conservation Commission and Rec Department or whoever else might want to do one. Because
yeah.
Now we've kind of got our foot in the door, so that's.
I agree. It was pretty easy to set up the account.
Yeah.
And to post the the event, and yeah.
I mean, so I think if we
you post it, you almost don't even have to go back to it.
No. Once it was posted,
you can see who's there, and you can print an Excel list of who's there.
I think if we get it all set by say February of 2017, that will help us. You know, even if it's just us again, we could probably double or triple the number of people that we have by having it more in place. And that was partially my fault. I didn't know what the timeline really was at all.
I think that was perfect for our first go around.
Yeah.
I think that was a perfect.
It was manageable.
Group of people. we got really good people that were really easy going.
Yep.
And they were very enthusiastic about it the whole time, even after lunch.
Yeah, it was good.
Less enthusiastic. They were so
it was good. We removed a lot of unwanted plants from that area, so I was happy.
We did. We were
productive.
We got all of that, a big clump of burning bush out of the stream area near the field edge. That's where we started. And they jumped right into it.
Yep.
they wanted those first, which are the harder of the
Yeah, we started with the hardest stuff. That was good.
Yeah. And then moved on to the barberry. And we basically cleared out everything that we looked at up to the wall.
Yep.
And
nice.
then even went further back in away from the field. On the towards the backs of some of the houses,
yeah.
And the stuff. One thing that we did that is the stuff that was right by the field edge. We actually pulled out into the field and brought it across the wet area to the drier part, and that's one thing I hope to actually just ask Rick if he can swing in and get it, or if we decide maybe he can't do it. I guess we could pull it back into the woods because the farm, the person who hays the field wouldn't. That stuff is going to get tangled in the hay pretty quick.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There are two pretty good sized piles out in the field, just right on the edge.
Mm.
And when it dries out here in the next week or two, maybe you can easily. I drove my truck out. Remember when we brought in the bridge?
Like, that's about where they are. Oh, so you okay. could easily drive to them.
Yeah.
Well,
so I could even drive my truck out there and fill it with it.
Could we leave them there and burn them next winter when there's, you know, could we put up some flags or something to say, hey, don't hay right here.
Right.
And then burn them next winter?
Probably. I think it's all barberry, though. I don't know how well barberry burns.
How many truckloads like do you think?
A lot of barberry.
It's one truckload. It's not that
yeah,
much.
Yeah, yeah,
we could easily.
They're
bring it to the brush dump and meterize it.
We just don't know if we're even supposed to bring something like that to the brush dump.
I think they burn everything over there, don't they? They get it in a big that cement thing, and then they smash it.
I think they do.
None of it has berries. So, I don't believe they reproduce that well vegetatively. So I think we probably can transport them. We just have to. I'm sure people put all sorts of invasives into the pile.
I do. I mean, I have.
Okay. I just don't. Yeah, I wanted to make sure
we're very leery of getting compost. Still makes me nervous.
Okay, so maybe if we have some, I'd be happy to help.
I think that's
go pick that up on Saturday if anyone has a truck. I don't have a truck, but.
Yeah,
I'd definitely
be
willing to help.
I need to go to the dump myself. I can't go on Saturday.
Yeah, or we could do it on a Wednesday.
Yeah. I could do it on a Saturday, but not for a couple weeks.
Okay.
I think it's fine for a couple weeks.
It's definitely fine.
We might want to just email about it again or something.
Sure. That sounds good. Yeah, if we're covered with berries, I'd be nervous. But it's like just bare.
Yep.
It probably won't even berry.
Got it early.
Yes. But thank you. Make sure that they know they're well appreciated.
I don't have
their email addresses or ways to
I thank them all, and they get thanked by Liberty Mutual in several different ways for their participation. So
thank you, Patrick.
They were happy to do it. I think they enjoyed it. Everyone, it was a nice day. It was a good day to be outside.
Yeah,
in a cubicle,
it
so that's
perfect.
Always.
Yeah,
nice.
It was good weather for it. It was like in the 50s, some breezy, sunny.
Yeah,
so it could have been better. And thank you, Andrea, for getting the tools and returning
We definitely needed those tools, so that was helpful. Yeah.
I'm taking them back as well. I used one of them at home.
Yeah.
That one after that, I went right home and pulled out a multiflora rose that was probably 8 feet in diameter that I've been.
Oh.
Afraid to tackle over the last couple of years because of its size. It took me like 3 hours to get that one plant out. So
there you go. You didn't have to buy any poison.
That's right, and that's why I didn't. So I didn't have time to take the tools back that day because it was just Monday afternoon. I was tearing that thing out.
Yeah, they're only open I think Wednesday through Friday. She said.
Oh, they were. She told me there was going to be someone there till 4, but I didn't finish until about 5. So.
She said I couldn't bring them Monday or Tuesday, so Wednesday.
Interesting. So, well, thanks again to everyone. If you're watching at home, thank you so much. Thank you, Patrick. Thank you, Andrea.
Yeah.
Next item is Wigan Farm boundary maintenance. Is there anything new?
Yeah, so not a whole lot new there. I just reached out again this week to Scott Boudreau related to getting that line surveyed. So hope to hear back from him shortly.
Okay. Thank you, Drew. I put the scholarship and field trip funding
for that. I have two applications for the scholarship that we can talk about after we adjourn and decide. And I can let Pauline LaBranche know. And if we want to, have you traditionally done the presenting or the chair does the presenting on scholarship night? She asked what we were going to do with that. And I told her I would talk about it and let her know.
Typically, the chair presents. I didn't last year because we had a meeting, I think. And I think Drew had to go anyway.
Yeah.
So Drew
yes.
presented.
Okay.
So I'm open for anyone to present that would like to. I don't mind presenting either.
Well, I'll get dates and circulate.
Okay.
The graduation day and then, or scholarship day. And then
okay. Somebody will most likely be able to be there.
I think one year we had no one present because we had a meeting and there was a...
No, I think we've always had someone present.
Okay.
Yeah. I think so too.
Okay.
Excellent. It's pretty easy.
Yeah, because they don't want you to talk long, right?
Right.
Yeah. So I mean I don't mind talking either. So I would be more than willing to go do it as long as it's not some other conflict that we have to deal with that evening.
field trip funding, did a letter ever get to anyone?
No, so I looked, I just sent something out right before the meeting. I looked around a little bit and sent out, the last letter that we sent out was from 2012.
Oh, wow. Because I know we had people even use it last year.
So I think it would be good for people to look at the letter that we sent out in 2012, and you know, we can make suggestions to it, and then we can update it, and we can figure out how we want to handle it going forward.
That sounds good. Because I know I've brought it up to people, you know, that I know that are doing field trips that are, you know, natural resource oriented type field trips, and I've suggested it to people.
Well, it's probably too late for this year.
People are still doing field trips this year.
They're still doing field trips, but so yeah, they've got them all planned. They get a lot right in the next 6 weeks. But so yeah, maybe we certainly, if we got them something this summer, that would be great, because I'm sure that's they'll be planning the field trips for next year. Yeah. So then they could incorporate,
yeah, if they don't
that
have funding currently, or if they're asking kids to bring money, and they could come to us potentially. But it would take a meeting to approve it. So that's the only thing.
Right.
They would have to get to us. Yeah, we would have to have a special meeting. Probably, you're right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So probably not going to happen this year. But yeah, it's.
But we can get it to them by August, so they can think about it for next year.
That sounds good. That's something I feel strongly about. And so we can just do election of officers, I guess. Are they called officers? I can't remember how you termed it last year.
Yeah.
Election of officers. So I don't even remember how the process actually works. Do you wait for someone to make a suggestion and then
People nominate.
Yeah.
So the officers are basically chair, vice chair, and treasurer.
That's right. Exactly.
There you sit.
There you sit.
Can I nominate Patrick?
Patrick is an alternate.
I'm an alternate.
Oh, okay. Oh.
So we have three people.
I thought
that's or Marianne. Marianne Hannigan is a full-term
member. Yeah.
She can be nominated and voted in absentia.
Oh, Marianne.
She's going to be chairman Marianne. Can we do that? That wouldn't be fair.
Okay. I'll renominate myself for treasurer for another year.
Can you do that?
I'll nominate Andrea to be treasurer next year.
I was going to say that.
Assuming she's willing.
Yes,
willing.
Yes, I'm willing.
We have to second. I'll second the nomination if one is needed.
Yes, I think it is a good idea. And I think we should vote.
We'll never
any further discussion on the nomination of Andrea continuing to serve as treasurer?
No.
Thank you for continuing to serve as treasurer.
Appreciate it.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 5-0. I will nominate Drew to continue to be vice chair.
I am willing to continue to be vice chair.
I will second that nomination.
Excellent. Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. And I would like to nominate Jeff to continue to be chair if he is willing.
I am willing.
I'll second that.
Thank you, Bob.
You're welcome.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
5-0.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Gentlemen, ladies.
I would once again make the suggestion that if.
Yeah, I actually got my application. I just haven't turned it in. I've turned it in to the town council, don't I?
To the upstairs to the.
Town administrator's
office.
Town administrator's office.
They're helpful business hours.
How many
openings?
Town
administrator's office.
You can slip it under the door.
I can?
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay.
You can, yeah.
Because I tried to get there today, but
there are two.
It's hard.
Unless they've received an application that they haven't shared with us, there are two.
Okay.
To Bob and Fred.
Bruce.
Bob, Bruce and
two
Fred.
Two positions, you mean, right?
Two
yeah.
positions, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Bruce and Fred's
Fred.
Positions.
Okay.
And unless anyone has any further older
thing.
Business.
So the fishing gate is open down behind the mill, and it will be for another few weeks or so, because they're counting the river herring. So if anybody has a curiosity, you can go down there and talk to the fish and game guys, Kevin and Mike, who run the logger every Saturday at 11:30 to count the river herring. And they had a presentation in down there last week that I went to and tried to get volunteers for. And I ran into Peter of the Dam Committee, and he said there's been talk about them building a wall on top of the existing wall that's down there, sort of at the top of the fish ladder, to protect that building that's, I guess, the Durham Book Exchange. Mm. And he said mm-hmm. that if we so desired, he would be willing to come and speak to us about this.
It's not going to have an effect on the fish ladder?
No.
And it's not going to have an effect on the flow of the river?
No. It's flood protection for right. that building.
It's just like in case
and
it gets...
And residents on the other side, I believe they talked about building that wall up. But there was some talk that it would be 4 feet on one side and 6 feet on the other, and they couldn't exactly remember. And so... Mm.
That's related to the fish ladder, or it's related to...
It's related to the dam and flood control.
Yeah.
So, I didn't know. We didn't hear anything about it. I thought it was interesting, so...
Yeah, if they're interested in telling us, if it doesn't affect...
He just put it out there as an offer. If we wanted to hear about it, he'd come talk about it.
I am interested in other things about the dam, for sure, in the long term, but... Maybe.
He said nothing.
That's a very nice
happen,
offer.
And they probably won't take it out. Ever.
Ever.
Who is this speaking?
Very long-term vision.
This is Peter. I'm blanking on his last name. He's on the dam committee, though. And I believe he works at Lake Bay Discovery Center on Nature Conservancy. You know that guy?
Oh.
Wellenberger?
Yes. No.
Older gentleman?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
I got a question. Has anybody heard anything about adopting a road cleanup was done last year? Have we heard anything?
I've thought about it.
Who was that?
About it.
I saw Amy at the meeting the other evening, and I forgot to ask her.
Wasn't
about
Amy
it.
Last year. It was the town councilor.
Amy Burns. But it was also Tony, Tony Weinstein.
Tony, I thought was, yeah.
But Amy was involved as well.
That was townwide. I participated in that. We cleaned streets all over town. That was great.
Yeah, I'd like to know when it's going to be held.
It happened, you said?
No, that was last year.
Yeah, I did it last year. I've done it
for this year.
I thought she gave us a date.
I don't remember her giving us
a date. Maybe just a speculative time frame.
I guess you could reach out to Tony.
Not this year, though, because, I really meant to ask Amy the other night, and I forgot, and because they like to do it before leaves come out, because of poison ivy leaves and stuff, and I was actually really surprised that they didn't bring it back up, because it was pretty successful last year.
Yeah, and I didn't know about it.
I actually thought about driving down the road the other day, thought about a mailer to people, but the mailer might end up on the side of the road with everything else.
Creating problems.
but like, just to encourage people in front of their own property to clean up the roadsides.
I do that. Pick up cigarette butts. That's all it's really
about. Well, if there's anything that we can do to ask them to find out.
The only thing I thought about suggesting that to I don't know how much we want to encourage getting people on the edge of the roads. On some roads, it's dangerous. But I thought about something like in asking Steve to put it in the town newsletter. And, hey, roadside cleanup.
Wear reflective
or
bright-colored clothing.
Bad idea. Yeah, I know, exactly. All year long in front of your property. I don't know. But
it would be nice, too.
I can think about that.
I don't know if anyone supports that or not, or if it's kind of a dangerous suggestion to make.
I support it, but I think it goes along with like home ownership.
Well, if they're going to do something, I'd like to be part of it.
Yeah. So do you want me to send an email to? I can send an email to Amy and CC everyone and Tony. I don't know if I have Tony's personal email though, and she's not on town council anymore, right? So I don't know that I have her. I had her newmarket.gov email, but I don't know if I have
Facebook. I could contact her that way.
Okay.
Oh, when did she get off the council? I didn't know that.
Maybe she is on the council. I don't think so.
I don't know. She still was. No, she left.
Maybe she is?
I didn't know that she left. I think she's still on.
She's okay. Still on? Okay, then she should have an email.
Yeah, yep. So I'll email both of them and CC everyone.
Sure.
And see what they say. They were all over last year, so
yeah, it was great. This would be the time where they would be.
Yeah.
And if they're not going to do it next year, we should definitely do it next year.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
Without a doubt.
Yeah.
Okay.
Liberty cleanup.
Yeah, Liberty.
There you go.
Yeah.
Can you get Liberty to do orange instead of blue shirts?
For safety?
Yeah. For roadside safety.
That's a little out of my pay grade. It's being made much higher up than me.
That's a nationwide thing.
Yeah, it is. It's actually international, yeah. They do it all over the world.
Hmm. Excellent.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much, everyone.
All right.
I'm not going to announce the date of the next meeting because I don't know it.
June 9th.
Does anybody want to read these and help decide?
At Durham was gloating.
Okay. Well, I don't have students there, but our daughter graduated last year, so I still know too many students.
Okay. I can do it with you right now. I'll just ask. I'm just
gonna
ask.
I've already read them, and I've
all lined up. They hated them all. They had 600 hours.
Yeah.
Work.
So that's what I wanted to tell. I need to get with Steve, and I can tell.
The middle school